So far in this course, we have studied virtualization using virtual machines. In this lecture, we are going to study how virtualization works using containers. So what are containers? Containers are a way to do lightweight virtualization. So for example, here on the right, you can see how virtualization happens with VMs. So there are multiple VMs on a physical machine, and each VM comes with its own complete copy of a guest operating system, user processes, and so on, right? So every VM replicates the full operating system functionality on top of a host operating system and VMM. On the other hand, containers do not have their own separate guest OS. All containers on a physical machine share the same underlying base operating system and the kernel. So containers only have a different view of this operating system. That is, they have a different file system, a different root file system. That is what you see as your directory tree starting at the root. That view can be different. The libraries and utilities that are available can be different. The set of processes can be different. Users, networking, all of this. The view that you see of the system can be different in a container. But all the containers share the same underlying operating system. Therefore, containers have lesser overhead than virtual machines because you don't have multiple copies of the operating system occupying memory and so on. On the other hand, because containers share the same OS, they have lesser overhead, but they also provide lesser isolation, right? In the end, everything is going through the same operating system kernel data structures. So you also have lesser isolation and there is more interference from one container to the other. That said, containers by themselves are a good way to do lightweight virtualization. And they have much lesser overhead than virtual machines. So containers are built on two concepts, two mechanisms in the Linux kernel, called namespaces and C groups, right? So these mechanisms are provided in all the latest kernels. And using these mechanisms, you build this abstraction of a container. So in this lecture, we are going to study in detail about namespaces and C groups. So what is a namespace? Namespace is a way in which you can provide a certain sliced or isolated view of a certain global resource. For example, normally, if you do PS, you see all the processes in the system, right? But if you take some processes and put them in a separate namespace, the processes will only see each other. They will only see their slice of this process namespace. Similarly, whether it is, you know, networking, servers, port numbers, usernames, whatever it is, there are several things that you can slice. So if you put processes in a separate namespace, they will only see their slice of the global resource. So that is one mechanism. The second mechanism is what is called C groups. C groups is a way where you can set some resource limits. For example, you can say these set of processes cannot take more than 50% of the CPU, something like that. So using these two mechanisms, you can isolate processes, provide them a sliced view of a global resource, and you can set limits on that resource. So using these two mechanisms, you can implement some lightweight isolation and virtualization, which is usually referred to as containers. So there are several implementations of containers like LXC, Docker, and so on. So some of you may have used some of these before. So LXC is a general container. If you start an LXC container, it opens a shell and you can do whatever you can do in a regular shell. Whereas a Docker container is usually optimized to run a single application. From LXC shell, you can run any application. In Docker, it usually runs a single application. That said, the mechanism of both of these containers is similar. So what we will study in this lecture is how these things are built under the hood. If you had to create your own container like LXC or Docker, how do you go about doing this? And as far as it comes to using these containers themselves, you can just install and use them. There's several help and tutorials provided online. So the usage of these containers itself, we will not be covering in a lot of detail in this lecture. So now these are container implementations, and you also have, on top of these container implementations, you have container orchestration frameworks like Docker Swarm or Kubernetes. So what these frameworks do is they manage multiple containers across multiple hosts. For example, in Kubernetes, you can place multiple containers over multiple hosts, auto scale them, manage their lifecycle, and so on, right? So for all of these container frameworks, there are tutorials online, and this lecture will not cover any specific container implementation or an orchestration framework. Instead, we will understand these mechanisms using which you can build your own simple container. So these are some of the references from which the content of this lecture is based. So now let's begin with namespaces. So a namespace is a group of processes that have a certain isolated or a sliced view of a global resource. Okay. So if you don't do anything special, if you don't create a namespace, there is in general a default namespace for all processes in Linux. And by default, all processes stay in the default namespace. But it is possible for you to create a separate isolated namespace and put processes in those namespace to have a isolated view of some resource. So what are the resources that can be sliced? These are the six namespaces that are supported in Linux today. The first is what is called the mount namespace. So normally you use the mount and you mount system calls to mount and unmount a file system. That is at the slash, at the root, you mount a hard disk which has a certain file system, or at some other location in your directory tree, you can mount a file system. And that is your root file system view that all the processes have. Now, these mount points can be different for different groups of processes. By default, there is a root directory and a root file system. But you can isolate a set of processes and say that, oh, these processes will see a separate root file system, will see a separate set of directories starting from the root. Okay, you can isolate the root file system using the by placing processes in a different mount namespace. The next thing you can do is you can isolate the PID namespace or number space of a set of processes. For example, you can place three processes into a separate PID namespace, and these processes will see only each other. They will see themselves as having PID 1, 2, 3, and so on. They will not see all the other processes in the system. So in that way, you can isolate the PID namespace. Similarly, you can isolate the network namespace. Now, for example, you can just put a small number of processes in an isolated network namespace, so they will only see each other. Normally, if you have, say, two servers, both cannot listen on the same port number. But if you place them into separate network namespaces, they won't see each other. They are isolated, and you can reuse the same port number. Underlying, so for all of these things, the underlying Linux kernel is basically managing these namespaces, managing these different views for the different processes. So the next namespace is the UTS namespace. This isolates the host name seen by processes. So when you query the host name of the system, different set of processes can see different host names. Then you have the user namespace, using which you can isolate the user IDs. So the processes get a certain UID and a group ID, a GID. So you can isolate these UIDs and GIDs seen by processes so that some set of processes can act as a root in one namespace with UID equals 0 and so on. Then finally, you can also isolate the IPC namespace, like IPC endpoints like POSIX, message queues, and so on. We won't be touching in more looking into more detail on IPC in this lecture. So note that these namespaces are similar to this concept of chroot that some of you may have seen, but this is only used to isolate the root file system, whereas namespaces is a more generalized version of chroot, which can help you isolate, as you can see, along many more dimensions, you can isolate processes. So how do you create these namespaces? So there's an API, there's a set of system calls provided by Linux to create namespaces. There are three main system calls. So the first system call is the clone system call. So this is a more general version of the fork system call. So you can use the clone system call to create a new process and place it into its own separate namespace, right? So this is how the usage of the clone system call is. This is, as you can see, somewhat similar to fork. You will, you know, when a parent process calls clone, you will get back a new PID of the new child process that has been created. Okay, and you can give different arguments to this clone system call. You can specify which function the child should run, what is the stack of the child, and there are certain flags and arguments you can pass to clone. So amongst these flags, you can specify many things. For example, should the parent and child share the same memory image? Should they share files and all? There are various flags. Among them, some of the flags is, should the parent and child share the same namespaces, or should you place the child in a separate namespace, right? So that is one of the arguments, one of the flags you can provide. So if you say, put my child in a separate namespace, then what will happen? The parent creates a child and the child goes into a separate namespace, say a process namespace or a network namespace, whatever. You can specify what separate namespace the child should go into. Note that this is a general system call. By providing different flags, you can create threads, you can create processes. This is a very powerful system call. In this lecture and in the associated assignments, you will basically, we will use this to create separate namespaces and not necessarily use it to fork processes. So this is the first system call. You create a child and place it into its own brand new namespace, right? So the second system call, setNS, basically lets a process join an existing namespace. Now suppose somebody else has already created a separate, say, PID namespace and there is an isolated set of processes there. Another process can join an existing namespace using setNS. If you call setNS, this process, when the invoking process goes and joins that existing namespace, it leaves its parents, the default namespace, and joins a new namespace. So the arguments to setNS will tell you which specific namespace to join, what type of namespace is it, PID or network or mount, and so on. So the third system call is what is called unshare. So this creates a new namespace and places the calling process into it. Okay. Once again, the flags indicate which namespace and so on. So what is the difference between unshare and clone? Clone creates a new process and places that new child process into a new namespace, whereas unshare places the calling process into the new namespace. So unshare is basically equivalent to, you fork a process and call unshare, that is equivalent to calling clone. So once a process is placed in a namespace, it can open a shell, it can run applications, it can exec some application, it can do all the other things. And a process and all its descendants will basically continue in that new namespace. Okay, the fork children of a process will always continue in the namespace of the parent, unless of course something like clone is done once again, in which case a new namespace is created. Otherwise, by default, a parent and all its descendants will reside in the namespace of the parent. So now what are these namespaces? How do I know what namespaces exist on my Linux machine and how do I, you know, create them, join them and so on? So in general, there is this proc file system. So I hope those of you who have studied an operating system course are familiar with it. If you go to /proc/PID on your Linux machine, you will find information about this particular process identified by PID. So under this, if you look at /ns, proc PID ns, you will find a set of symbolic links, right? You will find a set of soft links. And these links point to the namespace that this process belongs to. For example, here the shell process, if you look at its proc file system information, if you read this IPC file is basically pointing to some this actually is a pointer to an inode, which represents that namespace. You can just call it as a namespace handle or, you know, a file representing the namespace. So this IPC file will point to the main handle of that namespace. So these are called handles or names of namespaces. So this string here identifies an IPC namespace. This string identifies a mount namespace. And if you look at this file mount of a process, it will point to whichever mount namespace a process belongs to. So two different processes which belong to the same namespace will basically have the same value here for this namespace handle. And if you create a new namespace, a new such handle will be created. And these handles are what are passed as arguments to system calls. For example, a process can give such a handle as an argument to setNS and say, okay, I want to join that namespace. And processes within a namespace, if you look at their proc file system entries, they'll have the same handle. Processes in different namespaces will have different handles. Okay, so once again, this is the same tutorial I've pointed to earlier. Please look here for more details on these namespace handles and how to use them. So next, let us look into a bit more detail on some of these namespaces, right? So let's begin with the PID namespace. So the PID namespace basically isolates a set of processes, right? For example, in a VM, if you create a set of processes, those processes will only see each other. They will not see whatever processes are there on the host machine. Similarly, in a container, if you put a bunch of processes in their own PID namespace, they will only see each other. They will only be aware of each other. They will not be able to look at the processes outside the container. That is the purpose of the PID namespace. So the first process that creates the PID namespace will basically be given a PID equals one. It will act as the init process in that namespace. And from then on, whatever other processes it spawns will get PID 2, 3, 4, and so on, just like a regular system. And this first process that creates a namespace will get a PID equals one, and it will act as the init process, and it will do some of the traditional jobs of the init process, that it will reap the orphans of that particular namespace. For example, here is the default, say the parent namespace, and some process has called clone, created a child in its own PID namespace. Now this child will get a PID equals one inside this namespace, and it will act as the init process in that namespace. Now, and all its future processes will get PID 2, 3, and so on, right? If P2 forks a child, this P3 will get a PID equals 2, and so on. Now, a process, now these processes cannot see the processes in the parent namespace, right? P2, P3 are only aware of each other. If you do PS inside this namespace, you will only see these processes. They are not aware of the processes in the parent namespace. But a process in a parent namespace is aware of all the processes in all the its descendant namespaces, right? A process can see all other processes in its own and in the nested namespaces. Whatever namespaces have been created from this namespace, another namespace you create. So the parent process is aware of all its descendants, okay? So P2, P3 are not aware of P1. Inside P2, if you look at the parent ID of P2, it is basically zero. It is saying, I have no parent. I'm the first process here. On the other hand, P1 can see P2, P3 in its namespace, right? In P1's namespace, there will be entries for P2 and P3, just that they will have different PIDs, right? So P2 cannot exist in this namespace with PID equals one. Why? Because there is some other process PID equals one. There is the init process of this namespace. So P2, P3 will also appear in this namespace, just that they will appear with different PIDs. Okay, they won't appear with PID 1 and 2. That is, P1 can see P2, P3, all its descendants. P1 can see all of them, even though they appear with different PIDs in the default namespace. But these processes cannot see their parent namespace processes, right? P2, P3 will only see each other with different PIDs. That is, the PID of a process changes with the namespace it is in. In this namespace, P2 is the init process. It's the first process, PID equals one. But in the parent's namespace, it is not anybody special. It is yet another process that has some PID. Okay? So I hope this clarifies the concept of PID namespaces. So let's take a few more examples. So as we've said, the first process acts as init. It has special privileges. Other processes, for example, cannot easily kill or send signals to the init process. If the init dies, the namespace is terminated. However, the parent process in its parent namespace can kill this child process, right? In the previous slide, P2 prime could have been killed by the parent. So here P1 spawns P2, P3. Now P3 has to treat P2 like a special process, okay? Now let's understand who reaps whom with a little bit more examples. So P1 spawns P2 and P2 spawns P3. In this namespace, P3's parent is P2. So P3, if P3 terminates, it is reaped by P2. Now, if P2 terminates, that basically terminates this entire namespace, and P2 is reaped by P1. So, init process is reaped by the parent in the parent namespace. In the parent namespace, remember that P2 is seen as another process with a different PID, and P1 will reap that process. Now, what happens if suppose a process Q1 spawns a child Q2, and this Q2 joins this namespace, say using setNS or something, right? Q2 somehow joins this P2's namespace. Now, Q2 has another child Q3, and now Q2 terminates. Now, Q3 is orphaned. Now, this orphan is reaped by P2 because in this namespace, this is the init process, and this Q3 orphans in this namespace are reaped by P2. Just like how orphans in the parent namespace or in the default namespace, any orphaned process is reaped by init. Similarly, orphans in a namespace are reaped by the init of that namespace. So one final thing to note with respect to PID namespaces is that the namespace related system calls behave slightly differently when it comes to PID namespace. So clone, of course, behaves as expected. When you clone, a new child and a new namespace for that child are created. However, things like setNS, there is a slight difference in how they work for PID namespaces versus all other namespaces. So normally what we've said a few slides earlier, setNS changes the namespace of the calling process. A process can give an existing namespace and say, I want to join that namespace. However, for setNS and unshare, the current calling process's PID namespace will not change. Only from its child process onwards, the changes will happen. Okay, this means that once a process is created, you can never change its PID namespace. You can only change the PID namespace of new processes, not of existing processes. Why is this? This is because a lot of programs, so PID usually, if you use the get PID system call, it will return the PID of the process in that namespace, right? Get PID returns the PID in the namespace that the process resides in. So if a process changes its namespace, suddenly its PID will change, right? And a lot of programs make this assumption that get PID returns the same value throughout the lifetime of a process. Therefore, for this reason, Linux does not change the PID of an existing process. Only future processes' PID will be changed, even when you do things like setNS or unshare. This is the only difference. This only applies for PID namespaces. And for all the other namespaces, setNS will change the namespace of the calling process, except for PID namespaces. So now that was about PID namespaces. Now let's briefly look at a couple of other namespaces. Let's start with mount namespaces. So what is the root file system? So whenever an OS boots up, there are a bunch of mount and mount system calls done, which basically mount the file system from a disk. And that creates your view of the root file system, starting from the root, starting from //bin, lib, user, home, all of these are mounted at the root, right? Using the mount system call. Similarly, you can mount multiple disks and multiple file systems in your root file system. So this is the view of the root file system that all processes see. Now, what you can do is you can give different set of mount points to different processes by placing them in a different mount namespace. So if you create a new mount namespace, you can have a new set of mount points. So those processes in that mount namespace will see a different view of the root file system. So in general, any mount point can be shared or private. Right? When you mount, you can specify, do you mount it as a shared mount point or a private mount point? A shared mount point by default is propagated to all namespaces, whereas a private mount point is not propagated. So normally, the main file system is mounted as a shared mount point. So you may not have realized this because normally you mounted everything as a shared mount point. So across all namespaces, you will see the same root file system. But suppose you want to create a process that has its own separate file system, root file system, what will you do? You will make all mounts in the parent private, and then you will create the child and place it in a separate mount namespace. So now, because these mounts in the parent are private, these mount points are private, they won't be shared with the child, and the child will start with an empty root file system, and then in the child you go and mount your own root file system the way you want. Suppose in different containers you want to provide different set of applications, different libraries and so on, you can do that by mounting different file systems in different containers. So container frameworks effectively use these mount namespaces to give each container the illusion that it has a separate root file system and it's running on a separate machine. Even though underlying the base OS kernel is the same, they will basically mount different binaries and libraries to give containers the illusion that they are all separate. So all container frameworks, they come with what is called the base image or the root file system image. And this separate, by mounting separate root file system images for separate containers, you can give the illusion that they are all isolated from each other. So one interesting thing about mount namespaces and how the ps command works, right? So normally on a Linux shell, you open a shell, you type ps. How does ps work? So Linux has what is called the proc file system. Under slash proc, if you look inside this directory, you have information about all the active processes in the system, right? So there's normally any underneath or any directory in the root file system, there is a file system on disk and you read it from the disk. But this proc file system is special. It is not a regular, say, ext3, ext4 file system you find on the disk. Rather, it is a separate special file system. When you read a file in this proc file system, you are not reading a file from disk, but rather you are fetching information from the OS. If you read information about some particular process slash proc slash PID, if you read the information from that directory, this proc file system is actually fetching information from the OS and then displaying it out on the screen for you. So the PS command simply works by reading this proc file system, reads information about all the processes in the proc file system and displays it for you, right? So that is how PS works. So now here is the problem, right? Process P1 clones P2 and places this P2 in a new PID namespace. But everybody is using the same mount namespace, right? P2 is also using P1's mount namespace. It is viewing the root file system of its parent. Now, this process P2, if you open a shell in this new PID namespace, say P2 execs a shell, you open a shell and you run the PS command here, what will you see? You will see all the processes of the parent namespace itself. You will not see this isolated view of this PID namespace. Why? Because the PS command is still using the file system of the parent. Okay? So it is still using procfs of the parent's mount namespace only. So how do you solve this problem? Once you create a PID namespace, you must be able to see, when you run PS command, you must be able to see the isolated view of the processes, right? How do you get that PS to work correctly? So what you do is, when you put P2 in a new PID namespace, you will also put P2 in a new mount namespace and you will mount a new proc file system there. Okay, so once P2 is in its own separate mount namespace, has its own separate root file system, has its own separate proc file system, at that point, now when P2 in this new PID namespace, P2 opens a shell, in the shell you run PS, now PS will show the correct output. It will only show P2 and its descendants. P2 will appear like the init process with PID1 and so on, right? But this will only happen if you create a separate mount namespace also along with the PID namespace. Otherwise, there's nothing wrong, just that your PS command won't work, but still P2 is still has a PID of 1 in its namespace. Everything is correct. If you look inside the kernel data structures, everything is fine. Just that your PS display won't work correctly until you create a mount namespace. So next, we are going to understand network namespaces. So what is a network namespace? A set of processes look like they have their own separate networking endpoints and so on, right? For example, network namespaces can be created either by cloning, just like before, like PID namespaces, or even from the command line, there are certain commands you type to create network namespaces. And processes can join, all the existing network namespaces appear at a certain location on your system, and you can use the setns system call to join them, And you can also execute commands inside a network namespace by using this ipnetnsexec, right? Inside, so here you create netns1, you create this new network namespace. Then inside this namespace, if you say list all the links, you will see all the links of that network namespace. So what does this mean? A process can be in a separate network namespace. Now in that namespace, whatever, you know, servers it opens, whatever ports it uses, that information only stays within that namespace. That is, two different processes can be in two different network namespaces. Both can be listening on the same port, which would not have been possible had they been in the same namespace, right? So processes can create network namespaces, join them, and execute commands like see the, you know, list of links, create routes, create interfaces. All of that can be done in an isolated view of the network namespace. For example, inside this special namespace, this new namespace, if you look at, there's only the loopback device. Even though the machine might have other Ethernet devices and everything, you won't see them exactly inside this namespace because it is isolated. Okay, so once again, this link that I've pointed to has a lot of detail on how to create and work with network namespaces. Now, if a network namespace has only the loopback interface, right? I mean, what is the use of it? How is it useful to communicate with the rest of the network? So what you can do is you can connect namespaces with each other in the following way. So this is the parent namespace. This is your regular machine, say the default namespace. You have a loopback interface. You have an Ethernet device and so on. A new namespace only comes with a loopback interface. So what you can do is you can connect it to the parent by using what is called a VETH or a virtual Ethernet link. That is, you create a VETH pair. And this virtual Ethernet link, it has two endpoints. One endpoint you put in the parent namespace. The other endpoint you put in the child namespace. You give each of these separate IP addresses. So it's almost like this is a separate machine, right? And you're plugging in an Ethernet cable into that machine to connect it to this parent machine, right? So this is, instead of a physical cable, this is just a virtual Ethernet link, okay? So once you connect, so the previous, the tutorial link on the previous page has all the commands of how you can do this. So once you create a child namespace and connect it up to the parent, at this point, both these namespaces can talk to each other, right? So in this namespace, you can start a socket program. In this namespace, you start a socket program and they can both talk to each other. And through this parent's Ethernet device, now you can also create a Linux bridge here, connect this virtual Ethernet device to ETH0, and the packets can go from the child namespace through the Ethernet device outside through into the regular network as well, right? You can configure bridging, NAT, whatever you want to connect this namespace to the outside device. So this is almost like a separate isolated machine that has its own networking connected to the parent, right? So if you create a container with its own network namespace, you can run your own processes in an isolated view here and connect it to the parent as and how required. So that was all about namespaces. So with namespaces, you can isolate a set of processes. They'll have their own PIDs, their own networking endpoints, their own file systems, everything. You will get a separate isolated view for a set of processes. And most container frameworks, all container frameworks on Linux, use these namespaces to create that isolation, to create that lightweight virtualization for a set of processes. So that was the first building block, to build containers. The second building block is what is called cgroups. So what cgroups lets you do is, it is a slightly different concept from namespaces. Now namespaces were for isolation. You can isolate a set of processes with respect to any resource. What cgroups will do is, it lets us assign a resource limit for a set of processes. For example, you can say that all of these processes can only use this much CPU, can only use this much memory, and so on, right? You can divide processes into groups and assign resource limits for these processes. So this is the equivalent of, you know, you create a container and say this container will run on this CPU core. It will use one CPU core, it will use 1 GB of RAM, and so on. How do you set that limits? You set that limits using cgroups. So what are the resources for which limits can be set? You can limit the CPU, memory, the IO, and what is called CPU sets. That is, which set of CPU cores can the processes execute on, processes of a C group execute on. So there are few such resources for which these resource limits can be set. And you can say what fraction of CPU should be given to each group of processes and so on. Right? So normally you can create hierarchies of processes. Right? For example, for each resource, you can create a hierarchy, or you can combine multiple resources and create a hierarchy. So let's see an example, right? For example, you can create a hierarchy like this. All the CPU on this machine, you can divide it into two C groups. There is a CPU for, suppose you have a server machine in the department. You can create two C groups, one for all faculty and one for all students. And you can say all processes belonging to this faculty C group can only use 40% of the CPU. The rest 60% can be used by processes created by students. Right? So you can create separate C groups and place some processes are here, some processes are placed here, processes created by faculty are placed here, processes created by students are placed here. And these resource limits will be checked. Whenever a process is scheduled, the scheduler will update some, it'll do some bookkeeping. Oh, this C group, it belongs to this much CPU is used by this process. And you will ensure that these set of processes do not take up more than 40% of the CPU. The scheduler will ensure that. Similarly, the networking device or memory, you can say, you know, the network bandwidth, you create separate C groups and say this set of web processes will you will use 50%, non-browser processes will use 50%, right? So suppose a faculty member creates a browser process on this machine, then that process will be assigned to this C group here and it will be assigned to this C group here, right? So you can always tag processes to leaves in a hierarchy. There can be a multiple hierarchy. For example, under faculty, again, you can create assistant, associate, full professors. And then, you know, it can be as many levels as you want. And to the leaves of the hierarchy, you tag processes. And then the corresponding resource limits will be applied to this process. So instead of creating separate hierarchies for each resource, you can create a joint hierarchy. This is a combined CPU network hierarchy where you have four groups. Faculty web processes, faculty non-web processes, student web, student non-web, basically a cross product of these two hierarchies you can create like this. And you can assign resource limits here. You can say this is 10%, this is 20%, whatever, right? You can assign resource limits here. And now a browser process created by faculty will basically come and sit here, right? So you can create either multiple resources together or each resource separately. You can create a hierarchy that specifies how this resource of or group of resources should be divided amongst multiple groups. And once you create this hierarchy, the kernel takes care of executing this resource limits. The CPU scheduler or the memory allocator, all of these will look at this information and ensure that these resource limits are maintained. So how do you create C groups? There are no new system calls for it. This is just managed via the file system. So under sys/fs/cgroup, here basically you create different directories and subdirectories for your hierarchy. And within these directories, there are special files. For example, there is a tasks file into which if you write PIDs, those PIDs will automatically be counted as that C group, right? For example, you take this browser PID and you write it into this file. Under C group, there is a resource type, say CPU. There's a class, say faculty. And you create this hierarchy of directories to match your C group hierarchy. And in that, there will be a tasks file. You put a PID into that. Then the kernel will read this and it will ensure that the resource limits are maintained. And tasks can be assigned to leaf nodes. And once you assign a task, all its children will all automatically be placed in the same C group, right? For every process, you don't have to do it. Once you put like a founding father task into a C group, all its descendants will stay in the same C group. So this link has more details on how you can create and manage C groups. So after all of this, after namespaces and C groups, suppose you want to create your own container. How would you go about doing that? Suppose you want to run an application, a web server or some other application or a shell in an isolated environment, right? Just like a VM, but much more lightweight. How would you go about doing that? So first you create a bunch of namespaces for this application process, right? PID, network, whatever resources you want to isolate. suppose you're running multiple web servers in separate containers. For each, you have to create a separate network namespace so that each of them can be listening on their own slice of port 80. So you create namespaces, you create C groups, you place this application process into the corresponding namespaces, into the corresponding C groups. Suppose you want to create a container with one CPU core, you create a C group, place the application there, and set the resource limit to one CPU core, and so on, right? Create namespaces, create C groups, create a separate root file system, okay? That is tailored for this application based on what binaries and libraries this application needs. You create its own separate root file system with all the required configuration files and so on. Note that root file system should, all the binaries in the root file system, for example, should be compatible with the underlying architecture of the CPU, with the OS binary and so on, right? You cannot create, say, you know, your root file system has /bin/ls. It has an executable. That executable cannot be on a separate instruction set architecture from your CPUs, right? It has to be compatible. And there are several tools available that let you create these root file systems. And once you create this root file system, you basically make the process enter all of these namespaces, C groups, these mount the root file system, and so on. And now your application or shell or whatever can run. And once you run, you open a shell, you do ps, you'll only see the processes in that namespace, you'll see your own. You do ls, you'll see your own directory tree and so on, right? So there are several tutorials available online on how to create your own container using namespaces and C groups. So now let's come to existing container frameworks, right? You have things like LXC and Docker. So what are these? So these basically just do all of this namespace C group configuration for you automatically, so that you don't have to do all of this every time. You can just, you know, start an LXC container or a Docker container from the command line. And that container program basically is doing all of this namespace C group configuration for you, right? It will take a simple config file from you asking for your requirements. And from that, it will create this whole namespace C group configuration. So LXC is a lightweight VM like environment. So if you create an LXC container, it will basically open a shell for you. Just like you boot up a VM, it opens a shell. LXC container will open a shell with its own isolated all of these namespaces. And in that container, you can run your applications in isolation. And whereas Docker containers, they have a slightly different interface. So Docker containers are optimized to run a single application. You have to basically specify which application you want to run, on what is your base, what is your root file system, what all utilities the application will need, everything. You set up this whole environment for a particular application. And when you start a Docker container, that application automatically runs, right? So LXC is just a more, so you can open an LXC container, open the shell, run the application. Whereas Docker just makes it easy for you to run the application directly in a container environment. So which is why Docker is widely used to distribute applications, right? You can package an application, all its dependencies, libraries, configuration, everything, and distribute them very easily. And you can just install this Docker container on some other machine and the application can easily run because it has its own view of the root file system and binaries and configuration files and everything. So after these, on top of these container frameworks like LXC or Docker, you have other systems like, for example, Docker Swarms or Kubernetes and so on, right? So these are what are called container orchestration frameworks. That is, these frameworks are used to manage multiple containers on multiple hosts. For example, Kubernetes is a popular example. What does Kubernetes do? Kubernetes manages a cluster of multiple physical machines, which are called nodes. And each physical machine has multiple pods. And a pod is nothing but a collection of one or more containers, which are all in the same network namespace, right? So you can think of pods as containers, and you can create multiple pods, distribute them over multiple nodes, all from a single interface, right? So Kubernetes basically makes it easy for you to manage a cluster of containers. And what is this useful for? You can run a multi-tier application. Suppose you have a multi-tier application which has, say, a front end, it has a back end, it has a database, it has, you know, a web server on the front end that is reading web requests, then contacting some application server, which is talking to a database. So that is how real applications are built, right? They are multi-tier applications. each layer is talking to the next layer. The web server reads your request. Then you ask for some information. Then it will talk to a database. It will get that information, right? So there are multiple tiers, and each of these tiers can run in separate containers in isolation as if they are running on separate physical machines, right? You can place each of these tiers in separate pods, and these pods are then placed on separate nodes, and Kubernetes manages all of this for you for your applications, right? If you're building applications on a cloud, instead of you going, starting a container, typing a message on every, in each of the physical machines, you just use Kubernetes to do all of this for you. And Kubernetes does multiple things. For example, it will take care of placing these pods on free nodes. Oh, this physical machine has some free CPU. It will go put the pod there. And if a pod, the CPU utilization reaches very high, then it'll auto scale it. It'll create another pod with the same application so that your application now has two replicas, right? It'll do auto scaling. If a pod somehow crashes, it'll restart, right? So all of this management of all of these multiple pods on multiple nodes is automatically done by Kubernetes. That is the beauty of running applications on the cloud, right? A lot of people are migrating to these orchestration frameworks on the cloud. Why? Because otherwise, what would have happened? There would be some sysadmin who's managing each of these tiers in a multi-tier application would run on separate machines. Somebody has to go around all of these machines, restart them if they crash, manage them. If the machine is, too overloaded, they have to, plug in another machine. Instead of all of that, these frameworks like Kubernetes make it easy for you, right? They can easily move around pods across these nodes, do auto scaling, manage the life cycle of these applications. So you can read up more on these online through various tutorials, but in this lecture and in this course, we won't go into the specific commands to, start a Kubernetes cluster or a Docker container and so on. So in summary, this lecture has covered the basic building blocks of containers. So containers are a way to provide lightweight isolation with lower overhead than virtual machines. And the lower overhead basically comes from the fact that containers share the same underlying OS image. They just have different views for various resources. And this is implemented using two Linux primitives of namespaces and cgroups. Namespaces do isolation. Cgroups enforce resource limits. And all of these frameworks like Docker, LXC, Kubernetes basically build upon these two building blocks and provide more complex functionality so that you can easily use containers without having to know the details of namespaces and cgroups yourselves. But for a virtualization course, it is essential that you get comfortable with namespaces and cgroups, and this documentation and also the programming assignment in the course will introduce you to all of these things and let you create your own container using all of these building blocks.